Well, thank you for everyone, and good morning, and welcome to this special plenary session entitled Waste and Water, the Future of Decommissioning Efforts at the Fukushima-Daiichi Nuclear Power Station. My name is David Skeen, and I am the Deputy Director of the NRC's Office of International Programs, and I have the distinct honor of chairing today's session. We are very fortunate to have with us today senior executives from the Nuclear Damage Compensation and Decommissioning Facilitation Corporation of Japan, or NDF, and the International Atomic Energy Agency, or the IAEA, to discuss the ongoing decommissioning and decontamination activities at the Fukushima-Daiichi site. As some of you may know, about 10 years ago, I served as the director of the NRC's Japan Lessons Learned Division following the 2011 Great Tohuku Earthquake and Tsunami that resulted in the accident at the Fukushima-Daiichi Nuclear Power Station. I recall that even in the early days after the accident, we realized that decontamination activities at the site would be a very long-term effort, on the order of 30 to 40 years, and dealing with the large volume of contaminated water that would be generated at the site over those many years would be one of the most significant technological challenges for the government of Japan. I'm looking forward today to hearing from our panelists to get their views on the ongoing decommissioning efforts, including the NDF's unprecedented efforts that are currently underway at the site, and the lessons being learned that could have a significant impact on future decommissioning efforts worldwide. I am truly honored to introduce our two distinguished speakers who will share with us their respective agencies' unique roles in the ongoing Fukushima-Daiichi decommissioning activities. We will hear first this morning from Professor Hajimu Yamana, the President of the Nuclear Damage Compensation and Decommissioning Facilitation Corporation of Japan. Dr. Yamana served as a professor at Kyoto University, specializing in actinide chemistry and education for over 20 years, before being asked to lead the NDF's response to the Fukushima-Daiichi accident. He has served as the president of the NDF since 2015 and has devoted his efforts to safely decommissioning the facility ever since. President Yamana will address the NDF's strategic planning related to decontamination and decommissioning at the Fukushima site, including the technical challenges such as debris retrieval, spent fuel removal, waste management, and the associated regulatory considerations. Our second speaker is my good friend and colleague, Gustavo Caruso, who will discuss the IAEA's ongoing work with Japan regarding the planned release of the treated water from the Fukushima site. Gustavo has more than 40 years of experience in nuclear and radiation safety, doing regulatory inspections of nuclear installations, licensing of nuclear power plants with the Nuclear Regulatory Authority of Argentina before he joined the IAEA. In 2005, he was appointed as the head of the Regulatory Activities Section in the Department of Nuclear Safety and Security at the IAEA. And following the Fukushima accident in 2011, he was designated as the special coordinator for the IAEA Action Plan on Nuclear Safety in response to the accident and was the primary author of the report that the IAEA issued. Then in 2021, Director Caruso was selected to manage the IAEA's safety review of Japan's planned discharge into the ocean of the contaminated water that is currently being stored in 1,500 storage tanks at the Fukushima site. So following the presentations by both President Yamana and Director Caruso, there will be an opportunity for audience questions. And please submit any questions you have using the Q&A tab. So without further delay, I will now turn to President Yamana to introduce his organization and their activities related to decommissioning of the Fukushima site. President Yamana, the virtual floor is yours.
Thank you, Mr. Skeen. And hello, everyone. I'm Hajimu Yamana, joining from Japan. And I'm very glad to be with you today in this special session. So firstly, I'd like to express my sincere gratitude to the NRC staff for preparing for this meeting, and to Chairman Hansen for giving me this precious opportunity. Before starting my speech, please allow me to express my deep concern and sorrow on what is going on under war. It is as well my concern that nuclear facilities there are isolated by military force from the operator's own discretion and regulators' directions. So this is totally against our firm belief out of our experience from Fukushima-Daiichi accident that most important lesson to be learned should be operators' proactive responsibility for safe operation together with a completely independent guidance from the regulatory authority. So at the 11th anniversary of the nuclear accident at Fukushima-Daiichi, let me express sincere thanks from Japan to all countries who gave support to Japan through various types of international cooperations. Today, I will talk about the current status and plans for the decommissioning of the Fukushima-Daiichi nuclear power plant, as well as the plans for the release of treated water into the ocean. Please note that I will refer to Fukushima-Daiichi as 1F for short. So can I have my slide, the first cover page? So yes, that's good. Firstly, I'd like to talk about the organizational structure for 1F decommissioning. For the decommissioning of nuclear legacy that requires a long period of time, a prerequisite for success is the establishment of a solid organizational and management structure. In the legal framework of Japan's nuclear power business, the Tokyo Electric Power Company, TEPCO, is ultimately responsible for the decommissioning of 1F. On the other hand, based on the law on nuclear disaster response, the government created the Nuclear Emergency Response Headquarters, and TEPCO's decommissioning has to follow the line of this administrative guidance, which is managed by METI as a leading ministry. MDF is a government-affiliated corporation specially created to supervise TEPCO to fulfill its responsibility of compensation and decommissioning. It is also responsible for developing decommissioning strategies, managing decommissioning funds, and overseeing TEPCO's project management. And Nuclear Regulatory Authority, NRA, is responsible for ensuring the safety of 1F decommissioning from a complete independent standpoint. With regard to the release of treated water into the ocean, there are several relevant ministries to address the possible occurrence of reputational impacts to the society. So next page, please. The major risk sources to deal with are shown on the lower left. The two major radiological risk sources are the spent fuel stored in the storage pools in the reactor building, and the fuel debris solidified inside the reactor pressure vessel and primary containment vessel. These must be retrieved from the damaged reactor building within a certain period of time and brought into a safe storage state until the time when the final end state becomes ready. One complication is the inflow of underground water into the reactor building, and this results in the continuous generation of contaminated water. Similarly, there is huge amount of low-level radioactive solid waste that requires strategic management over the future. In the upper half of this page, I show the timeline of the decommissioning defined by the government's mid and long-term roadmap. Now, 11 years after the accident, we are at the end of the second phase of this table. Until now, various measures for emergency response and stabilization were taken to achieve the safe and stable status of today. In the second phase, we have completed about half of the spent fuel retrieval and are prepared to start fuel debris retrieval for the Unit 2 as the first implementing unit. We will start the third phase from around the end of this year to complete the recovery of spent fuel and prepare for the full-scale recovery of fuel debris within the first decade. The photo on the lower right shows a large remote arm that will be used for the inside investigation of the reactor vessel and for the small-scale trial sampling of the fuel debris at Unit 2. It is planned to start from this autumn. Please go ahead. Recently, attention is given to the issue of the disposal of the treated water, and I have focused on this subject in my talk. Treated water is purified cooling water that was contaminated from contact with the damaged core. Let me introduce the water management system being used at 1F site. Water is continuously injected into the pressure vessel to cool the damaged core, and the water flows out to the turbine building. In order to reduce contaminants, this water is treated by the cesium removal system and reverse osmosis system to feed it back to the reactor. However, significant amount of groundwater continuously flow into the building, increasing the volume of water in this circulation loop. The excess water is taken out and treated by Advanced Liquid Processing System, ALPS, to remove almost all radionuclides to satisfy the legitimate safety criteria for discharge to the environment. By operating ALPS system at its optimal performance of decontamination, the only remaining radionuclide in the treated water is tritium. This is called ALPS treated water. Due to the continuous inflow of the groundwater in the past, the amount of the treated water stored in thousands of tanks has now reached to about 1.3 million cubic meters, occupying massive portions of the site. It is estimated that we will run out of the space to build additional tanks within less than 2 years. Through dedicated study by the government, it was concluded that it is appropriate to release the ALPS treated water into the ocean, as long as the environmental safety is secured. This is a standard practice for all other nuclear facilities in the world, releasing tritium to rivers or oceans. This conclusion is widely supported by concerned experts who emphasizes the importance of sustainable long-term project of decommissioning. Next slide, please. This slide shows a plan for the ocean discharge of ALPS treated water. On the upper left, you can see the current storage status of the ALPS treated water. 1.3 million cubic meters are stored in about 1,500 tanks, whose tritium inventory is about 780 terabecquerels. The average concentration is 60,000 becquerels per liter. It is anticipated that about 5,000 cubic meters of treated water will be added every year. The plan to release ALPS treated water into the ocean is based on keeping the amount of tritium released per year below 22 terabecquerels, which was the upper limit license condition for pre-accident power generation operation. The upper limit of tritium concentration will be 1,500 becquerels per liter, because this has been already approved and used for the release of tritium containing groundwater to the ocean. It is just about 1/40 of the legally permitted criteria for tritium discharge. To ensure this low concentration, the ALPS treated water will be diluted with seawater nearly 100 times before the discharge, to respond to the public concern, an undersea tunnel will be built and the water will be discharged at 1 kilometer offshore and depths of about 10 meters. I should acknowledge that there is still a big debate and social confusion about this decision. However, we believe this decision is justified and unavoidable because we must keep focusing on risk reduction, such as the removal of the field debris and moving forward on decommissioning. It is natural that there are some key points to be confirmed for this operation. There are the confirmation of the sufficient removal of other radionuclides than tritium, the sufficient dilution of the treated water, precisely analyzed concentration of tritium, and so on. To address these concerns, open and transparent monitoring of all systems and discharges is required to continuous ocean monitoring will be essential too. In order to confirm the correct implementation, safety regulation by the NRA, and as well as the supervision of the project by the NDF, disclosure of accurate information and careful explanation are important. And as will be given from Mr. Caruso later, the independent supervision and evaluation by IAEA is indispensable. Finally, I have to touch on the fishermen and public are very concerned about the environmental impacts and the potential reputational damages. We fully understand these concerns, and the Japanese government is now planning to address these social impacts with various administrative measures. Go ahead, please. To conclude my talk, I'd like to remind you that the decommissioning of 1F has been progressing steadily, and we are making steps for the mid to long-term work, such as the field debris retrieval. About the ocean release of ARPS treated water, scientific safety should be the fundamental basis for the stakeholder involved discussion and understanding. I appreciate your further discussion and understanding on our approach, and we will be happy to provide necessary information to you. Thank you very much for your kind attention. Thank you.
Well, thank you, President Yamana, for providing the RIC audience here such a comprehensive update on the NDF's activities. And I'm certainly also glad to see that the NDF has been able to continue this important mission despite the additional challenges of COVID over the last few years. And I know that that's also weighing on folks' minds as well as you do your work.
Thank you.
As a reminder to the audience, please let enter any questions that you have for President Yamana into the question and answer chat box so that we can address those following Director Caruso's presentation. So now we will turn to Director Caruso to discuss the IEA's work with Japan that is related to the release of the treated water from the Fukushima site. So Gustavo, the virtual floor is yours.
Thank you. Thank you, David. Thank you very much. Thank you, Chairman Hanson, to invite the IEA myself to make this presentation in this online format. This month is 11 months from the accident. That's why I wanted to recall you that the agency organized an important conference last year where Dr. Yamana and Chairman Hanson has a prominent role there, and then the conference, A Decade of Progress After Fukushima, Building on the Lesson Learned for Further Strengthening Nuclear Safety, was a very successful one, and we're working with the proceedings at this moment that will be ready soon for the public consumption. Back to my first slide, please. Could you move on? The presentation, we have some outline, the background, the focus of IEA review and scope, the standards that we are going to use, the task force that was stated, components with of our review and different aspects regarding the recent progress and the looking ahead. Next, please. In April 2021, the IAEA and the government of Japan make an agreement of this based on the governmental announcement from Japan about the basic policy for handling the Alps treated water stored at the Fukushima-Daiichi Nuclear Power Station. And in this agreement, we discuss the how to make the review of the implementation plan, activities, all related to discharge of the Alps water that Dr. Yamana just explained before at the Fukushima nuclear power plants against the international safety standards. And this is basically inconsistent with our, totally in line with our statutory functions to provide the application of these international standards at the request of the parties, in this case of the member state. I wanted to clarify that this is not an inspection, this is not, we are not replacing any regulatory job, we just are going to fulfill the international work just to compare and to comply, to see the compliance with the with all the international standards that approved by all member states in this particular case of altitude water discharge. This review will be focused on it's a long range review before the water will be discharged, during discharge of the water that will last some decades, and after they complete the discharge of water to the sea. Therefore, our main activity was to how to ensure safety and transparency that are mainly key concepts of the review in order to contribute to the confidence building. Next, please. Then the scope, basically the scope we will focus, basically the mission is focused to the government of Japan. However, there are different players in this case. In one side is METI TEPCO, basically the responsible organization to prepare the application and to see how the technical compliant with the safety standard. And the other side is the regulatory body that we will also be part of our review in assessing and reviewing the standards, inspecting the application and issuing the organizations in compliance with our standard as well. Therefore, with these two, we complete the picture, and also the focus that basically will be, as I said, near term, mid term, and long term. That's why we have to prepare all our schedule considering this long range of this particular review. We will use the standards, of course, as a benchmark, and the conclusions, of course, will be based on the compliance or comments from using this standard as a reference level. Next, please. Then here you can see a number of standards that these are the key ones, in particular, starting from the BEXI safety standard, we call GSR part 3. These are the standard for radiation protection and safety radiation sources, and this is the requirement. But initially, we are considering the safety fundamentals, safety principles, that is the governing overarching requirements for all activities, safety standards that are below that, and also the number of guides that are related to the environmental and source monitoring, the radiation protection to the public and the environment, occupational radiation protection control of radioactive discharges, and prospective radiological environmental impact assessment. This is one of the key ones. Next, please. To do this work, the Director General, directed the establishment of the task force as a primary tool to implement all the work that we have to do, including 11 international recognized experts in different fields in these particular topics, in order to be sure that we have the international expertise needed in order to do this work. And they were appointed by the DG. And in addition to that, we have a number of staff of the IAEA that has the background on this topic to join us. And then we complete what we call a task force on this project. Next, please. The task force basically will serve the Secretariat as the leading component, and they will be chaired by the IAEA. Personally, I am the chair of the task force, and the objective of the Secretariat is providing planning, coordination, and implementing all the review and missions. We will provide the necessary expertise. We will produce the necessary reports, compiling information, drafting the text, and of course, be the liaison with any other necessary senior official in the government of Japan, on a member state or any other relevant stakeholders. The international experts, of course, they have the advisory role, important role, to the Secretariat to perform the function, basically review the information, highlight the relevant key aspect, attend the missions, participate with us in the missions, attend the task force experts meetings, and of course, participate in different activities planned by the IAEA. Next, please. In summary, this review will consider three important components. The first is the safety assessment, where we include all the technical radiation aspects that are considered for the plan and supporting this activity. In particular, considerations such as how to make the radiological characterization of the water, the safety related aspect of the engineering of the implementation of the system to discharge the water, the occupational radiation protection exposure, basically the doses to the workers, and the radiological environmental impact assessment. The regulatory activities, the other important components, is the review, what are the regulatory actions are considered to do, and the processes that the regulator, the Japanese regulator, are planning to do in this project. The safety objective, what are the most important requirements that from the Japanese regulator has in place, which regulatory assessment they are performing, and the inspections, and the inspection program, the oversight program planned by the NRA in Japan. And the last but not least is the independent sampling analysis, what we call normally corroboration aspects. In our project, the IAEA will make the corroboration of all sampling water, in particular, two things. One is the source water, how to characterize independently from the IAEA for our laboratories, what is the composition, isotopic composition in the tanks, and how to characterize the environmental samples that composed by sediments, by water, by seaweed, and fish. And these are made in the IAEA by three laboratories. We have three laboratories. One at the IAEA, we call Isotopic Hydrology Laboratory. Another one in Seisberdorf, is outside Vienna. And this laboratory is the terrestrial laboratory. And the Monaco, in Monaco, we have a laboratory for environmental monitoring. The three laboratories together, we are making an independent analysis. But not only that, we are going to involve third-party laboratories from other countries to again corroborate our independent measurement. Next, please. The outputs. What are the outputs of our program? In this particular, we will have many components which will be drawn through the years, through several years, and in multiple ways. For example, we created just an important website with public domain. We are producing reports different topics in particular from missions. We are giving briefings to the board, to member states, on particular requests, and making presentations, like for example, this one at RIC. The reports will be issued periodically to update all the work that we are doing with different components that they mentioned, with the three components that they mentioned before. And prior to the beginning of the discharge, we plan to make a summary report with our statements about the compliance the evaluation of the compliance of the international standard with all processes and activities that Japan is doing. The Secretariat, of course, will provide timely the briefings necessary to get a clear understanding what they were done and what are our conclusions. This is before the water discharge. After that, we will have another program, how to continue for a number of decades about this monitoring aspect to and inform to the relevant stakeholders. Next, please. What we did until now is basically, just to summarize, the government of Japan and TEPCO providing information on the ongoing review. For example, in November 2021, the environmental impact assessment. In January, the implementation plan, the entire project implementation plan. And February, we received the self-evaluation about how Japan believes that they are in compliance or what are the ongoing work in order to achieve the goal of compliance with international standards. We have several meetings with the task force since last year, since September, to review different steps of this process. And in February 2022, we have a very important mission that basically was divided in three parts. One, we went there with the three laboratories representatives to Japan to discuss how we are going to make the corroboration plan. Second, we made the first mission to TEPCO METI in order to review the one of the components, as I mentioned, the safety assessment, including the radiation aspects. And the last was the preparatory meeting of the regulatory mission that is going to be taken to take place in March. Next, please. Then we made the first mission, as I said, to TEPCO. It's the first in the process, more than one, but this is the initial mission to get the awareness of the situation, visit the place, discussing with the technical people, asking questions in order towards a comprehensive understanding of all the topics included to be part of the compliance of the standards. This mission will take several experts, like 15 members, and from the task force in general, outside members, inside members, and we cover, as I said, a wide range of topics. Next, please. We mainly focus on eight technical areas. We discussed the overarching requirements that needs to be fulfilled. What are the main elements for the characterization of the source temp? What discussing about radionuclides that are intervene in this process in different storage tanks? We discussed the different safety related aspects regarding the process and the reliability of the process, how the engineering is going to take place at the site in order to review what are the different situations, including any contingency plans for if something was wrong or going wrong. What are the backup situation? What are the safety systems that will cope with the situation? Something wrong. The other topic was the environmental impact assessment. We discussed all topics since what is the impact in the environment, dose limits and constraints, source and environmental monitoring programs, because another thing is, in addition to our corroboration, we are going to review how they're making themselves the monitoring program for the source term and the environmental and the environmental samples. And the how Japan is getting close and giving information to the interested parties or stakeholders for all this work. And of course, an additional, last but not least, we discussed the occupational radiation protection. It means that the IAEA will also corroborate the doses to the staff involved in this activity. Early results, as I said, we are working at this moment with different elements collected in Japan, and we are going to produce a report in a couple of months to identify several topics that we discussed and how to continue, because as I said, before the water will release, it's the ongoing dialogue that we are doing with Japan. Japan is working in different material and documents, evaluations that we discussed to be done. And then, as I said, this report will consider all these things and will be released end of April, optimistically, realistically, probably the first week of May. Next, please. In the future, I mean, where we go? I mean, we, as I said, this month, another mission that we are going to have is the first regulatory review about how NRA is making the regulating the safety case of the Alps City Water Discharge. And then we, as the same case of TEPCO, METI, we also will make a report after this mission in a couple of months after the mission in end of May. And then we have plans for the second half of the year to have the other missions, the continuation from the second mission for the TEPCO, METI, and the regulatory authority, including inspection programs and further developments that appear we need to discuss related to the prior to discharge the water. 2023 is the planned year where the water will be discharged. The agency will have a very, very dynamic time in 2023, in particular because we need to issue a final report of our views before the water will be discharged with the three volumes of the safety assessment, the regulatory review, and the corroboration assessment, including a summary, easily understandable, the summary for all people without nuclear background. And of course, we will continue the implementing the process for independent sampling. And we have to prepare in 2023 our program for during the process. During the process means that after the water started to be discharged at the sea. Then in 2024, long-term monitoring will continue under the current consideration and all that will be discussed with all relevant stakeholders. David, Chairman, this is what I have to tell you. I hope that was clear, and thank you again for giving us this opportunity for giving this presentation. Thank you.
Yeah, well, thank you very much, Gustavo. Really appreciate the comprehensive presentation that you provided. I know that at least here at the NRC, we will be following the work of your task force as you go forward, and we certainly look forward to continued engagement with the IAEA and the NDF on this topic. So we've got about 5 minutes for questions, and I've got several questions coming in. I think the biggest ones that we're getting right now have to deal with the stakeholders, right? So I think, I guess probably for Dr. Yamana first, can you talk about some of the approaches that you have had in consulting with the public and the stakeholders in Japan, and any of the challenges that you might have faced in your engagements with the public, and what were the lessons learned from those engagements? So, you're on mute, Dr. Yamana.
Okay, sorry. Thank you. Actually, there has been a significant distrust to TEPCO and discontent on the less frequent accessibility to the decision-making process in the government. This is people's opinion. So public engagement is absolutely important, and this is actually very important in the case of Fukushima-Daiichi. So for communication with the stakeholders, Japanese government has periodically held formal opportunity to discuss about the progress and plan of the decommissioning, including the water issue. With the leaders of the municipalities and some representatives of the relevant fields in the suffered area. On the other hand, NRA has had a frequent meeting to discuss about the safety of the decommissioning work with TEPCO, in which NRA commissioners and some opinion leaders debate the safety issues. This meeting is open by internet streaming. So there have been some other opportunities to have direct dialogue with the public, like the International Forum, which is held by my organization. But I'd say that the chance of the direct dialogue to the public was not so sufficient in the past. So I myself think that we need to expand this opportunity to talk directly to the public. I mean, the involvement of the stakeholders should be expanded more. So that is my view.
Okay. No, thank you very much for that answer. I appreciate it. And I know certainly the more open and transparent you can be on the plans and as the process moves forward, sometimes it's difficult to go through, but it is important to keep the public informed as the activities proceed. And I know certainly Gustavo and IEA will make all of their information public, so having them monitor and provide that to the public is also very helpful. So let me give you one, Gustavo, real quick. From your presentation, folks seem to say that while the review process on the proposed release, you laid out a pretty good plan as to where we are and where we're going to be in the next couple of years. But long term, how do you see the IEA monitoring the process? And just give us some of those perspectives on the project going forward.
Well, thank you for the question. Thank you, David. I think as I said, we have a very different milestones. Our first milestone is to produce to show to what extent Japan is fully in line with the standards. This will be done next year, let's say before the water will be discharged, and then everybody has the opportunity to see our evaluation, total independent evaluation, then some discussions probably. Japan will use this with the own stakeholders for this particular results. After that, as I said, in 2023, we need to prepare our own program, how we are going to first the transition moment, what I call is the moment that the all work preparations and imminently opening of the valves will happen, then the agency will be present for a time. And then after that, of course, we will continue to be present to as part of our review and witnessing, let's say, of all the activities in line with the standards. And after that, as I said, in 2023, we have to prepare the steady state program, how we're going to monitor and first of all corroborate what is in the sea, what is in the tanks in the routine manner with our laboratories, and then how we are going to take into account the task force discussions, what is going on. If of course our discussion is basically meant of any particular and small deviation, if any, we are prepared to discuss first among us, then with the Japanese colleagues, in order to be sure that we are in the same page. Therefore, we are fully prepared to design programs. As you know, this house, the IEA has enough experience on these particular projects. And then we are prepared to design a program to support and to demonstrate basically a science-based approach, transparency, and this will contribute all together to building confidence that the work that we are doing.
Well, thank you, Gustavo. I appreciate the response on that. And unfortunately, we've reached the end of our time today, so I'm going to have to conclude this special plenary session. But I want to thank our two distinguished panelists, President Yamana and Director Caruso, for taking time out of their very busy schedules to participate in this session with us today. I also greatly appreciate all of the audience for joining us virtually. I'm sure that having the audience hear these types of conversations is very helpful and educational for them. So if there are no other questions or thoughts, thank you everyone for participating today. And I thank the RIC audience, and this closes out our session. Thank you.